So last time we've discussed Fermi statistics and Dirac statistics, and we have seen that for small temperatures, then the distribution function looks like a step function. Okay. And epsilon is the average occupation. Now, this approximation is very good in metals, because despite the temperature being and also we have seen that this gives the specific heat, which is linear in T, which comes from the broadening of this thing here, I'm telling you that this thing is actually pretty good in metals. It's a pretty good approximation in metals, even at room temperature. Okay, why is that? Because essentially we said that this broadening is of order kBT. So if this broadening is much smaller than the Fermi energy, then we can, for all practical purposes, set the temperature to zero, okay, and discuss excitations on top of this step. If you do a calculation, so if you consider electrons in metals, so electrons in metals have a dispersion relation which is approximately quadratic, with the mass, which is not the electron mass, but it's the effective mass of the electron, which is of order of the electron mass. Typical metals, for example, in sodium, this thing is about half of the electron mass. So the Fermi energy is computed, as we said before, by simply integrating this thing in the epsilon, actually summing over all the states which are below the Fermi energy, and imposing that this sum is n, the number of particles. Okay? In this way we have the chemical potential, which is the Fermi energy, which has the form of 3 divided by 8 pi times rho, the density to the 2/3, Planck's constant squared divided by 2 times the effective mass. And rho is the number of electrons per volume. If you put the numbers for a typical metal, like for example crystalline sodium, you get that this thing is of the order of electron volts. Okay, for example, for sodium is 3.1 electron volts. Okay, so EF over KB, therefore, is of the order of 3 times 10 to the 4 Kelvin, which is about 100 times room temperature. Okay? So even for room temperature, this inequality is actually very well satisfied. Okay? So, and if you think actually 30,000 Kelvin is actually higher than the melting temperature of the crystal. So the electrons can be considered at zero temperature even while the crystal is melting. This has to tell you the power of the Fermi statistics. So the fact that two electrons cannot occupy the same state affect the system so much, even in the situation in which the rest of the degrees of freedom are just melting. Okay, good. So I want to give you a couple of examples of the applications of the Fermi Dirac statistic. So let me tell you, I mean, all the theory of transport in metals is based on the fact that you can consider this thing essentially at zero temperature. So the electron gas is an ideal gas at zero temperature. So what happens is that, you know, if I make an excitation on this thing, I essentially make a hole here and excited particle here. Okay. So typically we have this Fermi surface picture, which here it's either momentum or energy, and then I make a hole here and I create an electron here. Okay. And the rest of the electron C is completely unperturbed. Okay, so this is this picture in which we have the ground state of the system is a filled liquid, a Fermi liquid here. The Fermi sphere is filled and nothing else happens. It's the basis of the whole theory of transport in metals. Okay, good. So, let us now apply this thing, as I say, to a couple of situations, real world situation, and let's see what we get. So consider a semi-space of metal. So this is the z direction, it's perpendicular to the surface separating the metal from vacuum. Okay. And then let's make the assumption that inside the metal the electrons are distributed according to Fermi distribution. And then let's compute what is the probability, what is the probability per unit time that a particle, that an electron just gets outside. Okay, so the electrons are here. They are inside the metal, but then, and they are moving, okay? They move with the momentum which is finite because, you know, I have to fill the sphere up to a certain momentum, so there are states with finite momentum, even at zero temperature, and every now and then this electron can just fly and escape. Now, what happens if I take a charge? Now let's take my electron, let's plug it out here. Remember, this is a metal, and I have an electron here, point-like charge. What happens? If I take an electron and I put it here, and I leave it. What does directly do?
It can get attracted back to the metal.
Why? Say it again.
I expect that it can.
So let's solve the problem in which I have a point-like particle with charge Q in front of a metal.
It experiences a field.
Which field? Come at the black. Let's do it together. So, first of all, what are the boundary conditions for the electric field on a metal?
The boundary conditions?
For the potential on a metal. Neutral metallic surface.
The boundary conditions?
If I, this is an electrostatic problem.
Yes.
I have a charge in front of a metallic body,
yes.
Very large, let's assume infinite, and flat, completely flat.
Because initially I would expect that this metal is also made up of charges, I mean, and then using superposition I can. Okay, it's like this charge is going to experience an electrostatic, a force from each of the point charges on the surface of this metal. So what I will do is to sum them up. Okay, it will be an integral for the case of an infinite metal.
Okay, but how do you know what's the distribution of the charges in the matter?
It's periodic if it's a metal.
Say it again?
It's periodic if it's a metal.
No, I'm not talking about the crystal. I'm talking really about like electrostatic, like, you know, physics 102. I have a point-like particle in front of...
Poisson's equations? Maybe Poisson's equations.
What's the boundary conditions that I have to impose on an electric field on the surface of a metal? Say it again? The potential is a constant, zero is good enough as a constant, on the entire surface, okay? The line, the surface of a metal, is an equipotential surface. Why? What happens if it's not an equipotential surface?
Then the potential is not zero.
What happens if you apply a gradient of potential on a metal?
What happens to what?
What happens to a metal when I apply a difference of potential? You generate?
A current.
A current.
Yes.
So it's not an electrostatic problem anymore, right?
Okay.
So, in equilibrium, when nothing moves, there cannot be a gradient of potential in a metal. Okay?
Yes.
So the potential has to be constant here. So if the potential is a constant here, how do the line of electric field look like? So if in vacuum, I have a particle in vacuum, here, the lines of electric field, they look like this. Say positive, right?
Okay.
And the lines of equipotential are spheres, circles, when I draw the black. Here, what do they look like?
If the potential is constant, I thought that we could talk about the electric field just from this formula.
Say it again.
I mean, if the potential is constant,
yes.
I thought that we can conclude about the electric field just using this formula.
Yeah, you can always do that. So,
which basically,
which by the way, that formula is not one-dimensional, but you should use
gradient,
vectors.
Oh, okay.
Gradient.
The divergence.
It's important. It's not without it.
Oh.
Which are the vectors?
The vectors?
Which of these quantities are vectors, which are scalar?
This one is a vector.
Okay, let's put an arrow on top of it. Then, what else? And the potential?
The potential.
Potential is a scalar.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So the potential is constant on this surface. It's not constant everywhere.
Yeah.
It's constant on this surface. It means that point, different points on this surface have the same value of the potential. So how does the electric field look like?
If V, okay, this one is the potential.
Yes.
I would expect it to be zero.
No. One component will be zero. Because V is not a constant everywhere, but it's a constant along the Z direction. Along the Z direction. On the surface.
Yes.
Okay? Sorry, I'm not along the Z direction. I mean along the coordinates orthogonal to Z, X and Y. But it's non-zero. It's not a constant when I move away. So if this is a constant, it means that the tangential component of the electric field is zero. But the normal, not. Okay, the normal, it's not zero in general. So the only thing we can say from this thing here is that the electric field is directed along the normal. To the surface of a conductor. This is a very physical condition, because if there is an electric field which has a tangential component, the electrons will follow.
Yes.
Okay? And they will move until they have restored the condition that the potential is a constant.
Okay.
Because you have a current and the current dissipates energy.
Yes.
So at a certain point they will stop, because they are dissipating energy. And they will stop the equilibrium condition in which the force is zero. For the normal component, this is not true, because the electrons are not supposed to get out of the matter. So you can, electrons don't get out of the matter, in general. We will compute now the rate at which they get out of the matter, it's very small.
What about the concepts of thermionic emission?
This is what I'm trying to explain today. But if you don't know this, then I have a hard time explaining the thermionic emission.
Okay.
Okay. So this means that, you know, if the electric field is normal, the electrons try to move, the majority, the great majority will stay. There are order 10 to the 20 electrons in the matter. A few get out. If all get out, it's a disaster. Because that's a huge quantity of charge. Okay, if all the electrons leave the matter, okay, you notice, okay,
so
it's not a thermionic emission, it's a catastrophe. There are 10 to the 20 electrons which are jumping out, leaving 10 to the 20 ions there. Okay, so this doesn't happen. What happens is that a few electrons get out, but this is, at the level of electrostatics, this is irrelevant. Okay, for you know, a fraction less than the fraction of electrons that leaves the metal is less than, you know, fraction of 10 to the 10, 1 10 to the 10. Okay, so this get out, so the electric field can be like this, and it has to end on a charge, right? So it will look like something like this. Okay?
Yes, sure.
Okay, good.
These are the flux. They are called flux, I think.
Hmm?
We usually call them flux lines, okay, in the magnetic format.
Exactly, it's the usual thing, but one is supposed to be able to say. So, if the flux lines are like this, what does it mean? That the charge, so when I do, I solve this. So I can think of this as this charge in presence of an image charge, equal and opposite inside, and at the same distance. Okay? This charge really does not exist, as you were saying correctly. it's the result of the distribution of the charges on the boundary of the matter. So you can substitute the complicated distribution of charge on the surface with a simple charge here.
I have a question.
Yes.
Okay, originally, maybe I should not ask this, I don't know how it would sound, but originally I thought that if you apply a field to a metal, really electrons move in the direction opposite to the field.
Opposite, yeah, the direction is the same, the versus the opposite, yeah.
Okay, but in this case...
You're not applying a field to the metal here.
Then what causes the E and the V? If you're not applying a field,
you're adding a charge.
Oh, okay.
A charge comes with a field.
Yes, you're not
applying a step. Okay, so there is some energy. So there is some extraction energy. So since the charge is attracted by the image charge, by the remaining charges, if you want. Or by the remaining charges in the metal. So there is some kind of potential that looks like this. Okay? And it means that there is some kind of energy, a work that has to be done to extract an electron from the metal. Okay? So, only the there is tunneling, okay? There is quantum tunneling always, but that would really be a very very small effect. So the real effect here, because quantum tunneling is a real effect. I mean the most important effect is the tail of distribution here. That goes past the work, the extraction work. So the rate of emission is proportional. Well, this now depends. So the rate of emission will be proportional to the average of the z component of the velocity. Okay, because some electrons can have sufficiently high energy but move in the other direction, so we don't care. Okay. So what we need is the average of the z component of the velocity. And in order for this to be, so this is the average of Pz divided by m. And since we say that the electron has to have overcome the barrier of height W, then Pz needs to be larger or equal than the square root of 2mW. Okay. So how do we average this with this condition? Well, this is integral in dPz divided by 2 pi h bar from, let me call it this, well, square root of 2mW to infinity, and then the integral dpx dpy to pi h bar square Pz over m, and then we have e to the beta Pz squared divided by 2m plus Py squared divided by 2m plus Px squared divided by 2m plus 1. Okay? So this is the integral, this is 1 over h cube. Actually we need to add the 2 here because it's the spin of the electron. 2 divided by h cube integral dpz from square root of 2mw to infinity times pz 1 over m, and then the integral of this we do in spherical coordinates, so it's 2 pi p dp 1 divided e to the I forgot the chemical potential p squared divided by 2m. Actually, let's call this p parallel. P parallel squared divided by 2m times beta plus pz squared divided by 2m minus mu plus 1. Okay. I can rewrite this with a change of variables by s 4 pi m kbt integral Ez equals W to infinity in dz of logarithm of 1 plus minus mu Ez kbt. Now, if, so this is mu. W is larger or about the same quantity. So here I've done, so what I've done here? I've done the integral in dp parallel first, and I get the logarithm, because you see that this is just that you have a p dp here, and this is p squared, so this is the derivative. The denominator. So you do an integration by parts, essentially. And then I have changed variables to this pz squared over 2m being ez. And this can be between w and plus infinity. And then you have this integral here. So in the situation in which W is larger, more or less the same quantity as mu, which is much larger than KBT, which is the usual situation, as we saw, because typically the chemical potential of the Fermi energy is of order of 100 times room temperature, then I can expand the logarithm there and keep just the first term, because this is exponentially small, this is really small. So this becomes R becomes KT proportional to KBT integral between W and infinity dz of the argument of the logarithm minus 1. Okay? So it's kT squared times exponential of this quantity divided by kT. The current is proportional to the rate of emission. Okay, because every time we emit an electron, there is a charge of E comes out. So we have the current is proportional to T squared e to the minus some quantity phi divided by kVT. This equation dates back, it's due to Richardson, and dates back to 1890s. So well before the invention of quantum mechanics. The guy simply had, had an experiment, seeing that there is an electric current coming out of a wire which has been heated up, and this current has the dependence on temperature, which is like T squared, and then there is here some quantity phi, which is the dimension of an energy divided by kVT. This is actually a very interesting application, which was found by Edison in 1883. And the application is the following. Consider a circuit which is made like this. Minus. And let's consider this battery here, first in the configuration which this is minus, this is plus, okay? So this battery creates a current that flows through here, in this direction, okay? The difference of potential between these two points, let's say first is positive in this direction. So what happens? That the electrons, so this wire becomes hot, this thing starts applying, so there is a rate of flow from the electrons outside of this wire. The electrons get out and they're attracted by the plus, the positive plate. So the electrons are attracted, and this creates a current in the opposite direction because the electrons bring negative charge. Okay? So there is a current here. Now, due to these electrons that get out. Okay? What happens if I invert this thing here? If I invert this, this is minus and this is plus. Then this is minus and this is plus. Means that this is at a lower potential than the other thing. The electrons still get emitted. But then they get out of the metal and then they find another ramp. Because they get attracted again. So they get emitted and then they come back. Without ever reaching. Okay? So if this difference of potential is much larger than the energy that the electrons, that the typical energy with which the electrons get emitted from this thing here, there is no current. Okay? So this is, you know, this z direction. In one case, the electrons see this potential, and then they get emitted, and then they they roll down. In the other case, they get emitted and then they fly back because they bounce over here. So if I look at the current that flows in this thing here as a function of the potential, if the potential is positive, as I said, there is a current. If the potential is negative, there is no current. Because the only current here, if there was no thermionic emission, there would be no current. This would be like this would be closed, like a capacitor. This would be a capacitor, okay? So there would be just some current at the beginning and then a stationary state, no current. But now there is thermionic emission, so I can extract electrons from this thing here, but only in one direction. That's the thing. I cannot have electrons leave this to go here, because this is hot. This is not hot. So this has a much higher thermionic emission rate than this one. So electrons go in one direction. So this is called a rectifier. So if I have a potential which oscillates in time, the current will follow the potential only for the positive part. This is very important because inductance, capacitance, and the resistance are linear. Okay? They give you only linear electronics, meaning that the voltage that is across a resistance, a capacitor, or an inductance is a linear operator of the current. Okay? So you cannot do nonlinear electronics. And nonlinear electronics like diodes, transistors, they are the basis of a computational, of modern computers, essentially of anything, amplifiers, computers, anything. Okay? So, this was a big invention by Edison. In, what did I say? Actually, before these equations, actually. 1883. And the thermionic valve was invented in the 1900s, at the beginning of the 1900s. The diode. So this actually, the symbol of this thing is this. The current can flow only in one direction. If you try the current to make it flow in the other direction, it doesn't. Now, these things are made with semiconductors. They're not made like this anymore. You can find these thermionic valves in museums, or if you have a very, very old TV at home, your grandparents, my grandparents had a TV with thermionic valve. From the 50s. Late 50s. Okay. So another example is the photoelectric effect. In which, again, you have a Fermi C, there is some water extraction that you have to pay, and but the electrons now are extracted by a photon which comes. And the photon has to have energy, so the photon gives is absorbed by the electron and gives its energy to the electron. Okay. So it has to give an energy sufficient for the electron to jump across the barrier. So in the Z direction again. This, and this essentially gives us, so the calculation is exactly the same, only that now the rate of emission, the integral is now from W minus H bar omega, infinity dEz log 1 plus e to the mu minus Ez divided by kVt. And so there is a zero, which is mu, which is minus mu, which now before we were working in the situation in which mu, so this was the chemical potential, mu was here. W was here, okay? And now we have an extra H bar omega. So we can have H bar omega to be larger than this. So the exponential factor is not that important anymore. So we cannot, I'm just saying, sorry, it's not important actually. I'm saying that this thing can be, this thing can be rewritten in this way. It cannot expand in linear in this part anymore. This one, this thing is not small anymore. So I can rewrite this as kPt, and then I have bt square, and then I have integral dx, if I write everything in terms of kb, 0 to infinity of log of 1 plus e to the delta minus x, where now delta is this thing here, h bar omega minus h bar omega 0 divided by kbt. And here I've changed variables. X is dimensionless. It's easy divided by kVt. Okay? So now for large delta, actually, even up to order one, this thing here goes like delta squared. Okay, so this becomes kBt square times delta square, which is then, you see that the temperature drops out. This becomes omega minus omega zero squared times time constant. So the rate of emission is very, very small until omega is more or less equal to omega zero, and then starts growing. Okay? So, the rate of emission does not depend on the intensity on the light, of the light, but it depends on the frequency. This is an important, very important thing, which is due to the quantum mechanical nature of light. This is the reason why Albert Einstein got the Nobel Prize. Why is not important what's the intensity of the light? Because if you have many, many photons at low frequency, each photon will be absorbed by an electron. Okay? And these electrons will just do this. So a lot of electrons will get a little bit of energy. None of them will have sufficient energy to jump the barrier. In order for an electron to jump the barrier, it has to absorb many, many photons. If not to absorb many, many photons, this process is a lower order process in perturbation theory, because every time an electron interacts with a photon, you get E squared divided by H bar C, this alpha, in QED, if you do this kind of diagrams, you get a vertex. And this is a small thing. Okay? So it's 1 over 137 in dimensionless. So, in order for an electron to, even if the light is quite strong, in order for an electron to jump here, it has to be inundated by photons. And this is a classical process. And you can compute this classical process as a very, very, very small probability of occurring. But, if you have even a lower intensity light, but with high frequency, it's enough that one electron absorbs one photon and jumps up. Okay? So this, the fact that this thing does not depend on the intensity of light, but depends on the frequency, it's a manifestation of the quantum mechanical nature of light. Okay? So, I will stop here for today, because next lecture I want to start something completely different. How many lectures do you still have? Four, yes. So, for the next lectures, I want to start something completely different. I want to start revisiting ferromagnetism, and then I give you a hint of the, how to write the Landau-Ginzburg model for phase transitions, and how to start studying it. This will take the last four lectures of the course. Yes.
Yeah. I've ever heard of something called full wave rectification. Somewhere you drew a graph showing half wave rectification.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm wondering whether that circuit could be modified to have the full wave.
To have
the full wave rectification. Because you drew a graph, this one, showing that only the positives are.
Yes.
So I'm wondering how we can have this one also.
Oh, the other one?
Yes.
You put the diode in the other position. There is an arrangement of, you need two diodes.
I mean both.
Yeah, yes, okay. Yes. So you get when the potential is negative,
okay. You
need another diode. So there is I don't remember what's the configuration that you have to do, but you can have a perfect rectifier made with two diodes, in which both the current is positive. So you want something that does like this. Okay, so when this is the current, when this is the potential. right?
I was thinking that maybe if it's not a bed, that maybe we could, there is a wall just manipulating the voltage.
No. You need two of these things.
Okay.
One that reacts to the positive potential, and the other that reacts to the negative potential.
Yes, that one.
So you need one in the other, one in one direction, one in the other direction.
Okay.
I don't know, I used to know all these things, electronics, but I haven't been using it for the last 20 years, so I tend to forget things for 20 years. But see, I mean, you can do it essentially. Once you have this element, you can do whatever you want. The diode, the arrangement of diodes, like in a transistor, that allows you to do essentially anything you want with a given signal and signal processing. But now people don't. Typically, everything is done in digital signal processing, so everything is digitalized first, and then acted upon with the processor. But you can, I mean, if you look at projects and electronics classes, this kind of things, they will tell you, no. Now, let's build something that takes a wave and turns it into a wave of double the frequency, for example. Or takes, you know, it's a filter, for example, which makes it pass only things which are positive and about.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.